Hello everyone, good evening. So I'm going to take you through this interesting journey, what I call molecular PAP. So cervical cancer screening has undergone a lot of transformation over the years. The journey from conventional to liquid-based, and now the journey to molecular PAP and HPV being used as the first test in many countries. So let's see how this journey has unfolded and how you and me and the 1,000-odd gynecologists who have logged into this program can help save a few lives at least. Even if we save a few lives, I think our purpose is solved. So it's all about this little area, this transformation zone, which is there, which gets affected, unfortunately. It's not only the HPV that stays, it's the fact that it lingers and the fact that the lady's immunity is low and then it persists and then it replicates and then it creates cancer. But the interesting part is you and I have 10 years to intervene in this lady's body, and only then will it become cancer. But if we are complacent for 10 years, then definitely we are not going to help this lady at all. And she's going to land up with CA cervix. And many of us had CA cervix as one of our thesis project, and there were innumerable cases. And as you know, the chairperson said before this, that yes, the numbers have gone down. But have they really gone down? And can we just sit back and think, you know, that is it all right? No. If you look at the Globocon figures, whether of the world or of India, it will show up. CA cervix will just show up right there for you to, you know, stare at and say, oh my God, why are we not being able to control this cancer? And interestingly, here is one cancer which we know everything about. We know that a virus causes it. We know we can screen it. We know we can treat it. But yet it's there. So it's a little bit of a failure of the medical community, I would say. But the only way we can do anything about it is by become a little aggressive about it. So Metropolis became very aggressive 10 years back. And it is this 10, 11 year journey, you know, which I'm going to take you through. So obviously, as we all know, that prevention is the main strategy. And PAP is the best effective screening tool. And still, in spite of all of this, there has only been some result that we have been able to achieve. And the numbers are again stagnating. So again, some impetus is required. And what is that impetus? So we know HPV is the carcinogen. We know P16 is an excellent surrogate marker for dysplasia. But how do we really go about in the clinical practice and in the lab trying to cater to this? So no talk of cervical screening is complete without paying homage to not only, you know, Papanikolaou, but also to his wife. I don't know if any of you all know that it was her whom he sampled all the time. Has anybody undergone a pap smear? I mean, it's good this audience is not live. I mean, many of us will be guilty of the crime that we have not undertaken a pap test yet. But this lady, God knows, underwent how many pap smears, after which we all actually, you know, got to know what all goes on. But still, in spite of whatever Papanikolaou did, he did not achieve great success until he collaborated with a gynecologist, that is Herbert Ron. And this also shows us how collaborative synergy can work and how an interaction between the lab and the gynecologist is very, very integral to save lives. And of course, another person who we need to pay homage to is Zurhausen, because he was the one who actually came up with the HPV. Otherwise, we would all be clueless about what is really going on. And now, of course, we all are very wise. We know HPV causes anogenital head and neck cancer, and we know where it is more prominent, where it is, you know, Africa and Eastern Europe, Central Asia, where it's more prevalent as compared to other places where it's a little less prevalent. And we know that there is high-risk HPV, but all this information came only after the initial information. Also, I cannot go on without, you know, respecting my own seniors who have contributed a lot in this, Dr. Anuradha Murthy, with whom she's our senior histopathologist. And she and me, I think, have gone to every gaon, kasba, city, country to, you know, propagate cervical cancer screening. And of course, then there is Dr. Barodawala, Dr. Vikas. We are all part of a team. Dr. Shama, who is a microbiologist. And this is our international publication on this topic, which we had published in 2018 in Diagnostic Cytopathology. And it's freely available online. Any of you can go forward and read it. And then there is Ashwini and Ashish, who run the LBC and the HPV program with us. It is this team of people who, for the last 10 years, has gone crazy, along with thousands and thousands of gynecologists across the globe. And when I say across the globe, I actually mean it, because we get a huge number of cervical cancer screening from Africa, UAE, and of course, India. And I think we've impacted quite a many lives. Now let's see what exactly does this HPV do? So of course, it enters, it sits inside, you know, the epithelium, and it doesn't budge. It's like this unwanted guest who comes and sits inside all our women's cervix. And we cannot run away from it unless we don't have sex, and that's not possible. So HPV is like the common cold of the cervix. Anybody who has sex is going to get HPV sometime or the other. Question is, how long do you have it inside you? Is it a high-risk type? Is the rest of your immunity low? And is the virus replicating? And is it settling down inside your host cell genome? And that is when it starts creating problems. And most of you must have heard about the E6 and the E7, which only comes out when the virus replicates. So that is one molecular test which can help you to see that, okay, virus is there, but is it causing any damage? So if E6, E7 is there, yes, it is causing damage. And then, of course, this starts getting shed out. And only when it's shed can I see it, you know. So the cytopathologist only comes in once it's shed. But the virus is there and it is creating damage. But what does a gynecologist have to do? So every time a woman enters your clinic and she is of 30 to 65 years of age, you just, as you know, the previous speaker said, just take a sample. Whatever you take, conventional, LBC, HPV, sample her. Don't let her leave your clinic without getting a pap smear done. Because there is where you are saving a life. Just by sampling her, you are saving her. Because it is a huge time period. And you know, CIN1 just clears, 50% of them clear. Even CIN2, some of them just go away. But we have to catch them and we have to treat them. And that is what is most important. So this was a landmark paper that came out in the Annals of Internal Medicine in 2012. But some things have changed now in 2020. So I will touch upon both. Now, what was really, really important in 2012 was that it was the first time that the US Preventive Task Force said that you have to actually do a co-test, HPV and cytology, which is really going to help you. And if you do that, you can, you know, get good compliance from a patient by testing her only once in 5 years. But yes, if you do not do HPV, then you have to do a cytology every 3 years. So this is what they said, and preferred was the co-testing. And everybody agreed on this. American Society of Colposcopy, American Society for Clinical Pathology, American Cancer Society, everybody agreed on this. So let's, you know, rest this case, and this is there, no doubt about it. Now, what has changed in 2020? So earlier, the time to start screening was from 21 years of age. But now in 2020, they said there is no need to screen anybody less than 25. So that's a very, very big change. So we only start screening after the age of 25. Now, what exactly do we do? So starting from the age of 25, you can just do a primary HPV test every 5 years, which is the preferred. But obviously, doing a cytology adds sensitivity and specificity, which I will come across, which I'll show to you later with the help of many cases that we have done. So ideally, one should do a co-testing every 5 years. Now, till when do you keep on doing this? You do this till the lady turns 65. Now, once she turns 65, now this scenario is very different in India. So many of my cases, you will see 85, 95, and you will say, what is Dr. Geethi talking for? She said, don't screen after 65. Now she's saying this lady was 95. Yes, my friends, because that lady was never screened till 95. So this rule breaks if somebody has never been screened. So if somebody is in a constant screening program and they are negative every 5 years, then you leave her. But if she's 80 and she's walked into your clinic for the first time and she's never got a you know, cervical cancer screening done, then obviously you need to screen her no matter what age she is. Then supposing somebody has undergone hysterectomy. So individuals who do not have a cervix, but they have a history of CIN2, so that is where the whole thing changes. And last and not the least is the vaccination. So many times I get these questions as, I have taken a vaccine, so do I still need to screen? Yes, you do, because a vaccine only covers certain strains. And I will show to you how so many different genotypes are involved, that whether you are vaccinated or not vaccinated, you have to just follow the AIDS-specific recommendations for cervical screening. The HPV vaccine scenario is also very, very interesting. First, it was only bivalent, then tetravalent. Now there's a 9-valent vaccine. Earlier, everybody said before the first sexual exposure is the best time, you know, so 9-year-old, 11-year-old, my 9-year-old is vaccinated for HPV. I don't know whether yours is. You must go and vaccinate your girls. But now I just saw on Twitter that there is a US campaign going on and there is a vaccine which they say is even effective 45 years of age. So some of us only have a few years left and we should definitely take that vaccine if we don't want to die of cervical cancer. Like corona, nobody is really immune to HPV. So we have to be a little active about it. Now let's come to the tests. So obviously we all know there is a pap smear which is there. Nobody can deny it. Nobody can avoid it and nobody can circumvent it. But of course, there is HPV, then some of them are FDA approved, some of them cover genotypes, some of them don't cover, some of them give you a blanket strategy that, okay, high-risk HPV is present. But what I noticed that earlier we used to do the PCR, later we moved to the hybrid capture. And when it did not give the genotype, the gynecologist would invariably call us, okay, but what's the genotype? We said, hey, earlier you said we want hybrid capture and we want only high-risk. They said, no, we want to know the genotype. So we said, okay. So we reflex all our HPVs, all our pap smears, we reflex to HPV. If HPV comes positive, we do high-risk typing, we do the genotype typing as well, because we understand that it does have relevance. And also you need it for repeatability and for reinfection. So, you know, some women lead very colorful lives and the HPV strain keeps changing. And they say, it's okay, we just want to know whether we are good. So we said, okay, so we do give the genotype and we have a lot of women on follow-up. So let's come to PAP. What is really the goal of PAP testing? You're just trying to find these dangerous cells. That's all that you're trying to do. And you can find them by any method possible. So I have nothing against conventional. We have got both conventional and LBC in our lab. But when I will show you a few slides, you'll think, why do conventional? LBC is definitely better. Why? Because conventional, you may give an ambiguous report and you may have to do unwanted, you know, or excessive colposcopies. You may have to do repeat sampling. And you may have to, you will obviously reduce patient compliance. No patient likes a doctor who pokes her again and again. And this is a very, very uncomfortable test. I heard my previous speaker mention some, you know, excellent points upon how, you know, we should not miss it. That's very, very valuable. So there are some three essential steps for an accurate cytodiagnosis. Obviously, the time that you, the gynecologist, spends in making a good smear. And I can vouch for it. We have been very lucky. Metropolis has a huge gynec base. And all these gynecologists are super awesome. So we really don't have any unsatisfactory smears. I get very surprised when people say that, because we get beautiful smears, whether conventional or LBC. We always have the transformation zone captured in our smears. So because if it was not in the smear, we would not be able to diagnose it. There is no way we can pick up something that's not even on the smear. Then for my pathology friends who have logged in and the cytopathologists, there is no substitute for careful screening. You have to screen properly. Because if you miss this atypical cell, you are denying this lady the chance of, you know, a potentially fatal disorder to skip it. And then, of course, if anybody lands up with a positive smear, don't just leave it. Please follow it up with a confirmatory test. And there has to be an excellent liaison and dialogue between the clinician and the cytology department. And ultimately, it is your cytology, HPV, histology, colposcopy correlation, which is going to save the day. No isolated thing is going to save the day. So conventional pap smear has its own limitations. You know, you saw one case in the previous speaker slide where there was a lot of inflammation, which was a limiting factor. The cells were hidden somewhere. And this does not happen. So the solution to all this is just do an LBC, because first of all, you're just going to capture everything. Everything is going to go inside the vial. It is going to get preserved. The fluid is such that, you know, we've done a lot of studies, and the cells as well as the DNA, nothing happens to them for 6 to 8 weeks, you know, at room temperature. And that is so excellent, because we've had women who do a pap smear and then they've hopped off, you know, to the Europe or to the US. And then they come back after a month and they actually had an L-cell or they had an H-cell. And now they want an HPV done, but nobody wants to get poked again. So if the vial is lying in the lab, all that we have to do is reflex the HPV on top of it. So at least I recommend LBC to everybody, just so that your patient can be, you know, better off. That's all. This is what a conventional smear looks like, the figure on the top. And that is what an LBC looks like. I think even to a non-pathologist, it's a non-brainer that LBC is definitely better, because the whole challenge is to find the needle in the haystack, and you can see that complicated haystack on top. And you can see this very, very clear image below where, you know, if you have L-cell, H-cell, it's going to shout and scream at you that, hey, here I am. Please, clear me out as a positive report and let me get treated. So this is some of the images. That is the NILM, you know, negative for intraepithelial lesion or malignancy. We have to follow the Bethesda. Please don't make your own nomenclatures. It's only the Bethesda. And then, of course, you get actinomycotic colony. It's very frequent in, you know, people who've got an IUD inserted. So you see them frequently. Then you see L cells, the beautiful coelocytic cells, which you can easily pick up. These are all LBC smears, and these are easily picked up. Then, of course, you have HSIL with cells just glaring at you of high-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion. And this is how we give the report. So the report carries everything, the clinical details, the type of smear, the adequacy, the kind of cells, the inflammation, what is the abnormality, what is the HPV type, what is the genotype, and then in that whether it is a high-risk type or not. So the entire information is available on the Pap smear report, and the diagnosis is based on the Bethesda classification, because the gynecologist is going to act on it. So when you give this classification, if you say that this lady has got ascus, obviously the gynecologist is now going to do an HPV. If you say she has ascH, she's going to do a colposcopy. If you say it's LCIL, again an HPV is going to get done. If you say ETCIL, again a colposcopy and a biopsy is going to get done. So you remember that whatever you're writing on the report, the gynecologist is going to act on it. Of course, as far as histopathology is concerned, that is the gold standard. There's no denying it. Now let's go through our data. This is the Metropolis Pap smear data from 2009 to 2020. And you can see the number of lives, you know, that have been impacted. So there is close to 1.16 lakh samples that have been tested. And out of these, you can see LBC is the higher proportion, but definitely conventional is there. We don't reject a sample. That is the one chance that we have to save a life. So conventional, so be it. The age range, surprisingly, people are even, you know, testing from 17 years and it's going on to 94 years. This is the work that has come, nothing in our control. And then, of course, ascus and LCIL are the two most common abnormalities that get picked up. And the average HPV infection rate that we found in these cases is 13%. Now, actually, the Indian data is about 9%, but it is the African data which even goes to 15 and 17, and that is how the average that we have got is about 30. This is the journey that started, you know. We started with 111 samples, I remember, in 2009, and we were the crusaders against cervical cancer screening. And now you can see that, you know, it's mid-year and it's already 7,000 samples of LBC, and of course another, you know, 1,600 of conventional. So it's a huge number that we are seeing, and most of it is LBC now. It has completely overtaken the conventional. When you look at the abnormalities, it's very, very visible that you can actually catch the abnormality better in an LBC smear, no matter what it is, whether it's LCIL, ascus, ETCIL, everything is just easily caught because it is easily visible. And then it is easily triageable to the HPV. This is the HPV positivity. Now, again, I would like to, especially those who are vaccinated, I would like to tell you that you're only vaccinated against few of the genotypes. The remaining genotypes, as you can see, they're very much there. So the screening continues. High-risk HPV testing, very, very important. What are you trying to do? Anybody can have HPV, as I said. Is it low risk? Then nothing to worry. If it's high risk, yes, something to worry. Then in that, some of the genotypes are very, very virulent. So definitely something to worry in that. And then of course, sorry. Some disturbance, yeah. And then of course, we come to the vaccines. As I said, some of the vaccines are, you know, bivalent, some are quadrivalent, and now we have a 9-valent vaccine. So that's good, we are making progress. Unfortunately, the vaccines don't include HPV 35, and this is one of the most prevalent HPV types we have seen in India and also in Africa. So that's where the HPV and the HR stands. And as I said, in India, it's about 7.6. It goes up to even 23% in Africa, but the average that we have seen is about 13%. So it's not only the HPV, as you know, Saraya ma'am often finds, you know, says that, and we all know Dr. Saraya, she's one of the crusaders of cervical cancer in our country. And she always insists that it's the cofactors which really harm, you know. So the low socioeconomic status, the poor diet, and the concurrent HSV and the chlamydia. That's why she always, you know, works up a patient in holistic fashion and, you know, manages them completely, because it really affects. And these are the various disease associations that we see with HPV. Everybody knows about this. I'm not going to go into the details of that. I'm going to touch upon molecular studies. So there are a whole lot of molecular tests available. There is your P16, E6E7 mRNA, Pro-XE, in situ hybridization, and E6 oncoprotein. We have tried and tested all of them. And what works best is the P16. And that is what we call the ServiSafe, which we are very, very proud of. So HPV is a proven carcinogenesis, and P16 is an excellent surrogate marker for the HPV-related dysplasia. And this point cannot be negated. And it's very, very important to catch these women who has this. And once P16 is overexpressed, already it is a high risk. It is now SYN2, SYN3, nothing less than that. So often we get in biopsies also, somebody will release a biopsy report saying that this is query reactivated query post-radiation, query dysplasia, and we use P16 as a marker even in biopsies, if P16 comes positive. One more thing about the positivity of P16. P16 has to be positive in a biopsy in more than 70% of the cells in the nucleus and in the cytoplasm. Anything less than that is not positive. Now, in a cytology, even if you see one cell positive with P16 and Ki, which I'll show you, it becomes a positive case. Now, this is just one study which will highlight to you how the sensitivity and specificity jumps from conventional to, you know, SurePath to ThinPrep that we are using, and how it jumps when you use HPV. It's very, very important. The whole thing about screening is that you don't have to miss anybody. You can overdiagnose, it's fine, but don't miss anyone. So this is how, you know, you improve the sensitivity as well as the specificity. Now, if you miss on anything, you lose cases. And then unfortunately, they land up in high stage, high grade. And then, you know, you can do nothing but feel sorry. So I'll take you through some cases. So this was a 61-year-old lady, abnormal colposcopy. This was a thin prep, very, very obvious, high-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion. Naturally, biopsy being the gold standard, that was done. And, you know, again, it was a SYN3 on biopsy as well. This is another case, which is a LCL, as you can clearly see. The reflex testing was done. It was HPV genotype 16 positive. They did a LEAP, and this is the section from the LEAP. And as you can see, it is a very, very clear LCL. So you can catch these cases, you can treat them. This is a conventional pap, but it came as a co-test, and HPV 16 was detected. So, you know, very often this will happen. So, you know, this primary HPV testing is very dangerous, because you'll get a lot of these women who come as HPV positive, but they don't have any lesions. So what are you going to really treat? What is there to treat? So I'm going to touch upon this. How do you manage these women with HPV positive but cytology negative? So there are two options. Either you repeat the co-test after a year. I always tell them, repeat both the tests after a year. Or you immediately go in for a high-risk, you know, genotype testing if you've not done that already. And generally, when you will do a co-testing, you will actually get it sorted out, you know, after a year, that what exactly you should be doing. Then, of course, are some very interesting cases which you come by. This was a 35-year-old lady, and she was reported as an ascus twice, once in India and once in UK. And it was coincidentally the same time that, again, I was delivering a talk, and I had spoken about all these molecular markers, P16, blah, blah, blah. But obviously, half the people were not paying attention, or, you know, they had switched off. The moment you talk about the lab, you know, they had switched off. But this happened to be a relative of one of the gynecologists. And then she called me up, Kirti, what were you saying about all that P16 molecular? Can we do that? This is my own, relative. And she has been reported ascus. She's just married. She wants to, you know, have a family. She does not want to have this lesion. And can we treat it? What do we do about it? So I told her, you need to do an LBC with a co-test of HPV, and then we will give the report. And interestingly, VIP syndrome, always something different, always something unusual. This had the twilight lesion. It was not very clear whether it was an ETSIL or not. But this is a Syntec Plus, or the ServiSafe that we do. And as you can see, that both brown and red, pink, both are seen. So the pink stands for the Ki, and the brown is for the P16. So when these cells are positive for both P16 and for Ki67, definitely there is an issue. It is a high-grade dysplasia, and it needs to be treated. There is nothing else to be done. So this was our report. It was a molecular pap report that we give. We, at that time, we used to do in situ hybridization as well. So we had done KISH, and we said that the HPV viral is all virus is already integrated into the host cell genome. Then we did a ServiSafe, and we said we are seeing a dual positivity for HPV and Ki, so it's positive. So we gave a diagnosis that this is a case of LCL, which is progressing into ETSIL, and the HPV genotype is 59. When I released this report, the gynecologist called me up and said, this is a pap report. I said, yes, this is a molecular pap report. And then, of course, she did a colposcopy. There was an abnormal area. LEAP was done. And this lady is still on annual follow-up with us. This is a biopsy at that time. Just look at the Ki67. Each and every cell is like proliferating. But if this girl would have been left alone as ascus, or left alone, I don't know what would have happened. But today, she's fine. She's got a family. She comes every year. She does an annual pap. And, you know, we keep reporting it. And that's how we have many, many cases who keep coming back to us annually. So I'd just like to conclude by saying that there is definitely an imbalance in the disease burden, just because there is no proper effective screening and intervention system. And in spite of all the vaccinations, screening is required. And we all know that cytology has a low sensitivity and HPV has a low specificity. So neither is good alone. A co-testing is absolutely, absolutely essential. Then there are some promising biomarkers which have emerged, some of them being E6, E7 oncogenes and the P16A4A. The P16A4A is what we use and what we recommend. So I'd like to thank you and say the same thing that my previous speaker said, let's battle cervical cancer together. And I also want to just thank my entire team and some COVID warriors during this time. And as you can see, some familiar faces, Saraya ma'am, Dr. Maya, and all these, you know, crusaders against cervical cancer with our Service Safe program. Thank you so much.